to him for that. Andy Puzder is the former chief executive of CKE Restaurants, where he helped turn Hardee's and Carl's Jr. into globally known fast food powerhouses. Starting as founder Carl Karcher's personal attorney in 1986, Puzder became CEO in 2000 and led the company out of serious financial difficulties. Under his leadership, CKE expanded to over 3,800 restaurants. Puzder is a frequent lecturer on economics and politics for various groups and associations, as well as colleges and universities. He is also a senior fellow at the Pepperdine School of Public Policy, a member of the Washington University Law School's Board of Advisors, a director at the Job Creators Network, on the advisory and on the advisory board at Prager University. In 2010, Puzder co-authored the book titled Job Creation: How It Really Works and Why Government Doesn't Understand It. And in 2018, he authored The Capitalist Comeback: The Trump Boom and the Left's Plot to Stop It. His latest two pieces, Broadsides by Encounter Books, Getting America Back to Work, and It's Time to Let America Work Again, were released in 2020. We are, again, thrilled to have him here. Please join me in welcoming Andy Puzder.
Thank you, Claire. Thank you, Claire, for that generous introduction. And is this the clicker? This is the clicker. Good morning, everybody. It's wonderful to be here. And before I get started, I think I'd like you to know a little bit more about why it's important to me to be here this morning speaking to you, and why it was important enough to me that I actually tried to help bring you here. Raj talked me into it, but I have to admit, I went along. So I'm going to tell you a little bit more about myself. I did run an international restaurant corporation, but really, I'm a working class kid from Cleveland, Ohio. My grandfather, and this is him in the middle there, came to this country in the early 1900s looking for freedom, like many immigrants before him. And this is him working a construction job in the 1920s, so literally 100 years ago, which kind of blows me away. My dad was a car salesman in Cleveland, Ohio, and a World War II combat vet. You know, we were really just a working class family, but back then, you really didn't think about it that way. You know, everybody seemed to be working class. The kids on TV were working class. The kids at school were working class. It was really just the way things were. At least for me, up until the day when my dad came home from work, from being downtown. He sold cars in downtown Cleveland. We lived in a suburb. He came home and said, would you come with me to deliver a car, a new car, to a very rich man in a very rich area near where we lived? It was really just a couple of miles away, but I would soon find out it was really like on a different planet. It was like a completely different world than the one I was living in. So I go with him. We get in the car. Back then, it was a real rich guy. His name was George Humphrey, and he lived in this very wealthy area. If you're from the Cleveland area, it's called Hunting Valley. It's east of Cleveland. So we got in the car. We drove there, and we pull up to this gate. And it's in my mind, it's this huge. Now it's 10 years old. This is 1960. It's this huge gate, right? It's just massive. I don't know how big it really was because I was 10 years old at the time. But the gate opens up. Probably the first gate I ever saw where you pulled up and it opened up. And there's this beautiful white house. I mean, it's like it's sunset. It's like shimmering. The lawn is perfectly manicured. You know, there's flowers planted everywhere. The driveway is gorgeous. I'm really anxious to see what this house looks like inside. My dad pulls in and then turns to the right, like going away from the house. I said, Dad, where are you going? I really wanted to see that place. He said, Son, that was the guest house. We kept driving. We went by these stables, which were really nicer than the little ranch house that at that point I had one brother, one sister, my mom, my dad, and I lived in. The horses seemed to have a better place to live, and there were guys in livery, and there's horses in the fields. And we would pull around to this house that really was massive. And again, I was 10 years old, but in my mind's eye, this is Downton Abbey. This place is just huge. We pull up to the front. My dad knocks on the door. Mr. Humphrey comes to the door. They got along very well, and they talked for a little bit. They're changing keys where we're getting the trade-in, and he's getting the keys to the new car. Back then, even rich guys drove Fords. So we exchanged keys, and I'm looking around, and I'm blown away. I'm, I just, I, I mean, I don't know how to describe it. I'm looking at the, you know, the guest house that I thought was a mansion, the mansion that I thought, you know, that is a mansion, the stables, the fields, the horses. We're walking back to the car, and I asked my dad, I said, Dad, what does Mr. Humphrey do that he can live like this? And my dad said, well, son, he's a lawyer, and he runs a business. And I can still remember thinking like it was yesterday, you know, a lawyer. You know, I could be a lawyer. Now, I think it's important that I thought that. But I think what's more important is what I didn't think. I didn't think that son of a bitch is stealing from us. You know, he's in the 1% and we're in the whatever percent you're in when your dad sold cars in the 1950s and 1960s. No, what I thought was I could do that. And thank God I lived in a country where I could do that. There was a path for me to do this. You know, the country my grandfather left, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, there was no path. There was none. In our country, there was a path. It was an arduous path. This wasn't an easy thing. Now, I wanted to work my way through college and law school. I worked every, you know, dirty, difficult job you can think of. I mean, I painted houses, I cut lawns, one summer I busted up concrete with a jackhammer all summer in St. Louis. You've ever been in St. Louis in the summer? Some of you are from St. Louis University. Man, it's really miserable, right? I busted up concrete that whole summer and threw the chunks on the back of a truck. I mean, no job was too dirty or too difficult. I had a wife and two kids by the time I graduated from law school, and I did whatever I needed to do to make sure that we had enough money to pay tuition and for food and for clothes for the kids and rent, whatever it took. But there was a path, right? So why am I telling you this? Why is this important to anything we're going to talk about this morning on the morality of capitalism? Well, it's because eventually I succeeded. I actually became a lawyer. That's me with all the hair. That's my 47-year-old son now on my back. That's my dad to, it would be my left, but to the right side of the picture. My sister and now my 50-year-old son, who's a nuclear physicist at the bottom of this, at the bottom of the picture. And then there's more normal me running the company. But I actually became a lawyer who ran a business, right? I became much like Mr. Humphrey. Now, I didn't succeed because I was jealous of Mr. Humphrey. You know, I didn't succeed because I was greedy. You know, I saw an opportunity to improve my life, and I took it. The United States, this country in which we all live, is the only country in the history of the world where a working-class kid like me could have aspired to the level of success I was able to achieve with any realistic chance of achieving it. Had I been born in a socialist country, for example, the idea of lifting myself from the working class to another class either would never have occurred to me or would have seemed like an impossible dream. But luckily, I lived in a country where there was plenty of opportunity. And I think trying to improve our lives is something we probably all share. You people are all in school. I mean, you want to improve your lives. We all want to improve our lives. The question is, at your age, is there a way I can do this that's moral? Can I improve my life without being greedy and, you know, a terrible person who does evil things? Well, capitalism is often criticized by people who don't understand it, claiming that you can only get ahead in a capitalist economy if you're greedy. And in fact, just the opposite's true. To succeed in a capitalist economy, what do you need to do? Well, you need to meet the needs of other people. The only way you can succeed in a business or as a business person is by coming up with the goods or services other people need at a price they can afford. You have to meet other people's needs to succeed in your life. That's not greedy, that's altruistic. Right? When I was the CEO of CKE Restaurants, I didn't try and come up with the kind of burgers I wanted to eat or government elites wanted to eat. I tried to figure out what you people wanted to eat. We spent millions of dollars a year trying to figure out what products you wanted to buy and how we could sell them to you at a price you could afford. And if we hadn't done that, then you know, our competitors would have eaten our lunch, right? I mean, it would have been a very difficult situation for us. That's why companies go out of business. Capitalism empowers you. It empowers consumers to vote with every dollar they spend on what companies succeed and what companies fail. You know, is it the BlackBerry or the iPhone? You know, is it Ford or Tesla? We vote with every dollar we spend to decide which companies succeed and which companies fail. So you have entrepreneurs, people in business, constantly trying to convince you that they have what you need at a price you can afford. And the result is incredible abundance. This is your local grocery store, an Amazon warehouse, a shopping mall. Think about your grocery store, the thousands of products on the shelves, each one almost leaping off the shelves, trying to convince you that they have what you want at a price you can afford. And the result is this incredible entrepreneurial energy, right? You're trying to meet constantly, trying to meet the needs of other people. Capitalism forces you to take the desire to improve your life and to focus it outward toward the needs of other people. Now, what about socialism? Let's take socialism by comparison. What does socialism require you to do? Well, socialism has you take the desire to improve your life and focuses it on you. Because the way you improve your life is by getting the most you can of the goods and services that the government decides to make available. So you're competing with everybody else to get the most you can from a limited supply of goods and services. And what, you know, and so you don't really ever end up with that energy, people trying to meet other people's needs, and that incredible abundance. What you end up with are food lines. You know, all of these socialist countries end up with food lines because they just can't afford to feed everybody in their country. And if you're standing, whether it's in line to get food or medical care or gasoline, whatever you're in line to get, you're not thinking about the person in front of you or behind you. You know, you're not trying to think, how can they get more? You're trying to think, how can you get more for yourself when you get to the end of that line? And how do you get more for yourself? Well, you get more for yourself, same as in capitalism, by meeting the needs of the people who control the economy. In a capitalist economy, that's us. So we all want to meet each other's needs. In a socialist economy, you succeed by meeting the needs of people in power. You know, if you can meet the needs of those people, you can get more for yourself. So what's the results? Well, the people in power get tremendous benefits. Now, let's take a couple of examples. Let's think about North Korea, right? You know, North Korea, people are starving, right? You see pictures of kids, they're all skin and bones, people can't get medical care. Even the soldiers, you know, who Kim Jong-un needs aren't getting enough food. You know, there just isn't enough to feed everybody. How about Kim Jong-un? Does it look like this guy's missed a meal? Or Venezuela with Maduro. You know, Maduro's running the country. People are eating their pets. Right? The situation there is so bad. The United States tried to send aid. They blocked it. The situation is so bad in Venezuela. Can you imagine telling your kids they had to eat their pets? I mean, does it look like Maduro and his military buddies and his buddies in government are telling their kids they have to eat Fido? You know, I don't think so. That's because in a socialist economy, the people at the top do very well. It's everybody else that does very poorly. And how could Venezuela, seriously, Venezuela, the people are starving. This country has the largest oil reserves in the world. In 2011, it was the richest country in South America. How on earth could the people in Venezuela be starving? Well, quite honestly, that's the benevolence or the altruism of socialism. This is Caracas. If there's any of you from California, you might have thought LA or San Francisco, but it's Caracas, and that would be a different lecture, so I'm just going to leave that. But this is the benevolence, right, of socialism. You end up with a very, very desperate population and a lot of wealth at the top. But what about capitalism? Does capitalism really help poor people? Does capitalism really benefit people that, you know, aren't sort of at the top? You know, the Jeff Bezos and Steve Jobs and Henry Fords. Well, let's look. I'm going to show you a graph. This is a graph prepared by an economic historian named Angus Madison. He passed away, but in the United Kingdom, there's a foundation that continues his work. And what this shows is GDP per capita from the year zero, you know, the year Christ was born, right up through about 2020. GDP per capita is gross domestic product, which is economic growth, per person. Why don't they call it economic growth per person? Why do they call it GDP per capita? I think economists just like you to think they're smart. It's really just economic growth per person. But you can see around 1800, it just zooms up. I mean, it just shoots up. This is unprecedented. This affected your great-grandparents, your grandparents, your parents. It will affect your children and your grandchildren. If we can preserve capitalism, this is an incredible increase in wealth. unprecedented, an economic miracle. Now, I showed this to a son. He's now 30, but he was about your age when I showed it to him. And he said, you know, Dad, you're going to tell me this is capitalism, but this is the Industrial Revolution. I said, tell you what, let me show you another slide. This is a slide that breaks that shooting up portion of the slide into a longer period of time and by region by region across the globe. And you can see the first country to shoot up was the United States. Well, why would the United States be the first to shoot up? Well, it happened that fortuitously in 1776, a guy named Adam Smith wrote a book called The Wealth of Nations that described why you would want to have a capitalist economy and how to set one up. And the United States, we adopted the Declaration of Independence. By 1889, when we ratified our Constitution, we had adopted a free market capitalist system. And within 100 years, from about 1789 to 1885, we went from 13 backwoods colonies on the coast of North America to the world's largest economy. By 1885, we were the world's largest economy. We have been the world's largest economy ever since. Well, what about Great Britain, Western Europe? They had an industrial revolution, and you can see the blue line here. They go up about the time that we went up. They don't go up nearly as much as we went up. That's because the countries were basically monarchies. And then you ended up with the Nazis taking over in Germany, which Nazis, as any of you who actually got an education in high school would know, were proud socialists. You can see when, at the end of World War II, what happens when the socialists fall, the monarchies have fallen in World War I and World War II, what happens to Western Europe? It shoots up. That's capitalism. Best example other than the United States on this chart is Japan. At the end of World War II, the monarchy falls. General MacArthur goes to Japan. He sets up a democracy and a free market capitalist economy. And Japan shoots up for the first time in history. GDP per capita exceeds that in Western Europe. Eastern Europe shoots up after the fall of the Soviet Union, the world's largest socialist economy. Red China shoots up after it adopts red capitalism, which isn't even real capitalism. It's like, it ought to be red socialism. It's just hokey capitalism. And it still shoots up, right? Capitalism has an incredible impact on GDP per capita. But does it affect, what about poor people? Are poor people benefiting from this, or is this just the Rockefellers, the Carnegies, the Fords, you know, the Gilded Age crowd? Well, the World Bank does an analysis of extreme poverty. And they found that, you know what the World Bank is? It's a bank that provides financing for poor countries across the globe. It's wealthy nations contribute to it or are involved in it. Back, they found in 1820, 94 out of every 100 people in the world was living in extreme poverty. I mean, six people weren't. And by the way, those six people, probably two or three of them were just in regular poverty. I mean, it's just 94% were in extreme poverty. If you don't think there was a lot of poverty, read a Dickens book. I mean, poverty was rampant. By 2015, that was down to 10. 10 people out of 100. I asked a buddy of mine, and by the way, now it's down to about 8 or 9. It went up a little during the pandemic, but it's down in single digits now. I have a buddy who's kind of a techie guy, and I said, you know, why don't we take the World Bank data and the Angus Madison data and put them in one chart and see if they correlate, if there's a connection. So this is that chart. He said from two separate data sources, he'd never seen anything this close. You can see they bump at the same time. This is the impact of capitalism. Here, the Heritage Foundation, they do an index of economic freedom they have since the fall of the Soviet Union that compares economic freedom across the globe. The one that came out in January shows this is economic freedom. And as you can say, it took a dip during the pandemic. I think we all knew that. But if you look at the trend, economic freedom since the fall of the Soviet Union, this goes back to 1995, so a little after the fall. Economic freedom goes up. GDP in trillions of dollars across the globe goes up. Again, a little dip last year. And the percentage of people living in abject poverty goes down. I mean, this capitalism is an incredible economic system. It lifts billions of people out of poverty and creates incredible wealth. And this next chart will be the most surprising that you'll hear this morning. I'll bet none of you thought you'd hear Andy Puzder this morning quoting Barack Obama, but I'm going to anyway. Back in 2015, speaking at Georgetown University, he said, "We don't dispute that the free market is the greatest producer of wealth in history. It has lifted billions of people out of poverty." Right? There's no doubt this is an incredible economic system. It encourages you to meet the needs of other people. It creates incredible entrepreneurial energy. The result is wealth and reduced poverty. Now, why is that? Well, it's because capitalism creates a larger economic pie from which everybody gets a bigger piece. It's unequal, but it's a bigger piece. Everybody gets a bigger piece from a bigger pie. Socialism, because there is no economic energy, has a shrinking economic pie from which everybody gets an equal piece except for the people at the top who get a huge piece. Now, John Kennedy said this the best. He had this, by the way, he ran for president the year that my dad took me to see Mr. Humphrey. This is when he was president. And he said, a rising tide lifts all boats. What he means by that is that a rising tide lifts rowboats, it lifts yachts, and a growing economy, in the same sense, lifts the poor and the rich. Wealth isn't a zero-sum game. If you listen to, you know, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez or Elizabeth Warren or Bernie Sanders, you would think that the rich only get richer if the poor get poorer, or we can only help the poor get richer if we make the rich poorer. That's not true. What John Kennedy's thought was, and he was right, the rich and the poor can all get richer if we have a growing economy, which is why people in the United States have fared so well, because of our incredibly prosperous economy. You know, capitalism, prosperity and abundance, socialism, poverty and want. So I do want to talk a little bit about the inequality, because you hear so much about wealth inequality, income inequality, and capitalism does have certain people prosper more than others, right? We have great wealth with Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos and Steve Jobs and Henry Ford and the Carnegies and the Rockefellers, and then we have other people who don't do as well. And you might think, you know, that's like a terrible thing, but I'm going to tell you, that's not a defect of capitalism. That's a feature of capitalism. Because when you succeed in a capitalist economy, you succeed based on how much you benefit other people. In other words, your success is dependent upon how much you benefit others. Let's take Henry Ford. Henry Ford didn't come up with a way to make cars so that, you know, kings and queens, dukes and earls of his day could afford them. He tried to make cars so that the common man and the common woman could afford them. And he was tremendously successful, benefiting an incredible number of people who had to take a mule or a horse or walk, now could drive Model Ts. Or Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs didn't come up with the idea for smartphones so that he could benefit government elites. He came up with it for you and me. And think about how it improved and made your lives different. I guess you probably don't appreciate that like I did, but I remember rotary dial phones, you know, not phones that connected you to the world. Or Jeff Bezos, you know, Jeff Bezos, richest man in the world, always criticized for that. But really, he became the richest man in the world because he created the greatest distribution system in the history of the world. No country, no state, no individual, no government had created anything comparable to Amazon. And thank God he did so before the pandemic. These people didn't become tremendously wealthy because they stole from us. They became tremendously wealthy because they provided us with tremendous benefits. That's the way capitalism works. Throughout our history, self-made men and women, free from the restraints of government, have forged ahead with innovative ideas and solutions that have created jobs, wealth, and prosperity for themselves, but also for our entire nation. Yes, they improved their wealth. They improved their fortunes. But in doing that, they improved all of our lives. And they improved the human condition. And these people, they're not successful because they're superhumans, by the way. You know, they're not perfect in every aspect of their character or of their lives. You know, they're mostly just like you and me. They're like, there's some good and there's some bad, right? We have good things about us and bad things about us. But they do have some traits in common. One is they're risk takers. They're very hard workers, and they are passionate about achieving their goals. And their passion and their abilities, you know, can pay off for the rest of us. I ran an international restaurant corporation that employed tens of thousands of people across the globe. Some of those people made very good livings and stayed with the company throughout their careers. Others came and worked for the company, got experience they needed or cash they needed to be successful in other areas. That's been true for the 80-year history of the company I ran. But that's not thanks to me. The guy to thank for that is a guy named Carl Karcher. He's a young man who was a dirt farm, family of eight, lived in northern Ohio, right up on Lake Erie, was a dirt farmer outside of Sandusky, Ohio, realized the family couldn't support him during the Depression, decided to move to California, moved there in the late 1930s, and in 1941 spent every penny he had and bought a hot dog cart in South Central Los Angeles. This is Carl by one of those carts with his daughter and one of his employees. The first hot dog cart, this was a shed. The first hot dog cart was literally a hot dog cart, right? Over the next few decades, he turned that into a major restaurant company. By the time I met him in 1987, I was his attorney, he had a $500 million company with restaurants throughout the Western United States. Any of you are from the West, you know Carl's Jr., or if you spent time in the West. That's the chain that Carl started with his hot dog cart. You know, Carl, like me, Carl lived the American dream. This was his favorite sentence near the end of his life. A wonderful, wonderful man. Now, to respect what entrepreneurs do, to respect what Carl did, you know, we don't have to hold them up as models of morality, right? These aren't, capitalism, you know, isn't a religion. It isn't an ethical creed. It doesn't purport to tell us how to live our lives, and it doesn't purport to tell us what we need to do to create a society where we care about each other or treat each other as we should. Capitalism is an economic system, right? And businesses are engines of economic productivity. But we all know we're not going to have a healthy society if all we focus on is wealth, right? That's why healthy societies have healthy families, strong religious institutions, you know, flourishing arts, and other agencies through which people can find, you know, love, inspiration, moral clarity, emotional stability. Businesses are not and cannot be the sources to meet all of those needs. What businesses can do and should do is provide the wealth that continues to reduce poverty and empowers the rest of society to create the agencies that continue to deal with the problems that we face as a society. That's really the role of capitalism, is to create that wealth. And look at the United States is the most charitable nation in the history of the world. There's never been a country that's as charitable as the United States, even today. So, this should matter to you, and I hope it does matter to you, because I think like every generation, your generation wants to see prosperity. You want to see fewer people in poverty. You want the opportunities to improve your lives and meet whatever goals you've set for yourself personally. So I have great news for you. The economic system in which you've been raised and in which you live is the greatest economic system in the history of the world. It empowers our farmers to feed the world, because by feeding the world, they can better feed themselves and their families. It empowers our entrepreneurs to rebuild, you know, deteriorated urban areas, because by opening new hotels, restaurants, and grocery stores, they can benefit their community and benefit themselves. It's the best system ever devised for the poor and the marginalized. It empowers them as consumers who vote with every dollar they spend, causing the economic focus to be on them. And it provides them with the opportunities and the prosperities to lift themselves from one class to another. Now, it's called free market capitalism, and it's the basis for the American dream. And free market capitalism and the American dream are soon to be yours to defend. And that's really, to go back to the beginning of my talk, that's really why I'm here today. I'm going to give you a Ronald Reagan quote, which is, what Yaf's favorite president and my favorite president. I have another president that's pretty close, but that's current politics, so we'll leave that aside for the moment. But he talked about freedom, about the tie between economic freedom and political freedom. There's another great quote by Reagan who said that to have any kind of freedom at all, you need economic freedom and you need private property. But what he said here that I think is relevant to this morning's talk is that freedom is always but one generation away from extinction. That's true. And I'm here this morning because I don't want you to be that generation. I want you to know everything you can possibly know about this great economic system that you're about to inherit so that you understand the importance of defending it. And may God bless you in your efforts. May God bless each and every one of you, and may God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
We can start the line right back here.
I'm just glad I made it through. Yeah, you know, I spoke yesterday in Atlanta, and I lost my voice like two-thirds of the way through the talk, and I had to, like, stop talking for 5 minutes and get my voice back. So I'm just happy I made it through this morning. I think it was the adrenaline. Yes. Or the Diet Coke, although it's kind of woke Coke. I prefer Dr. Pepper nowadays. I'm sorry.
I'm Christian from Catholic University. So my question is, so we talk at Yaf a lot about big businesses kind of going woke. So do you think that there's a role for the government to step in and rectify that? Or do you think that it's better for us to kind of vote with our dollars like you were talking about?
Well, we do need to vote with our dollars, but for some things you don't have a choice. Like you want to fly in an airline, can you find a not woke airline? You know, you want to take your kids to a theme park, are there a lot of alternatives to Disney? I mean, everybody wants to go to Disneyland, right? The problem, what's happening with woke capitalism is something called ESG investing, which is a different conversation that I probably don't have time to give you the whole lecture today, but it stands for environmental, social, and governance investment criteria. So you've got these huge investment funds that take, you know, in other words, none of you have retirement accounts right now, but maybe your parents have a pension fund or a 401k plan, or you've invested in mutual funds or ETFs, some kinds of monetary investment, monetary products. Well, the big three that control most of that business are BlackRock, State Street, and Vanguard. They control about $60 trillion in other people's money. So our money, right? Even my money. Some of my money is tied up with these guys. And they take those shares and they vote those shares against the economic interests of the company, so that the companies will try and accomplish these radical environmental policy, social, critical race theory, HR programs that teach you that, you know, you're either an oppressor or the oppressed. Why on earth would you teach somebody that they were oppressed? You know, it's just horrific to think you would teach kids that. And then the governance is you put people on boards of directors, you promote them at their jobs because of their race or their sex. I've been fighting promoting people based on race or sex my whole career, but now that's like the in thing, you know, with corporate governance. Well, they go in and they meet with these directors and they say, you know, if you don't, you know, kind of put in maybe this critical race theory HR training program, I think, you know, you might be surprised if you get on your board. And Exxon learned this lesson last year. I don't know if you followed this, but a radical environmentalist hedge fund decided they wanted to put environmentalists on Exxon's board. Can you imagine? Oil's going like this. You got the largest oil company in the United States in Texas. And you want them to focus on, you know, sunshine and rainbows and, you know, this you know, alternative energy sources. Anyway, BlackRock, State Street, and Vanguard all voted with this little hedge fund, and now Exxon has environmentalists on its board. So rather than producing returns for shareholders or investors, the people whose money they hold, they're now trying to pursue these progressive agenda items. So it really is a refutation. If any of you studied Milton Friedman said a corporation's top priority is returns for shareholders. Well, ESG investing says your top priority is radical environmental policies, critical race theory, and promoting people not based on merit and character. So there is a tremendous amount of influence there that's diverting these corporations to adopt these policies. And there are things the government can do to rein in environmental, social, and governance investment criteria, because it's not in the best interest of the beneficiaries of these assets. and you have a duty as a fiduciary to act in the best interest of the people whose money you're investing. So the government, when Gene Scalia was Secretary of Labor, he enacted a regulation that said you can't invest this way for private pension plans. State pension plans aren't covered by federal law, so now states are enacting laws that are requiring these fiduciary duty obligations. But yes, I stopped buying Coke. I don't buy Coke. I like if you haven't tried Diet Dr. Pepper, it actually is better. I mean, it's really good. It actually tastes just like regular Dr. Pepper. And I avoid every company I can that, by the way, people say, like, I own Disney stock. People say, like, sell your Disney stock. That's the stupidest thing in the world you could do. Buy more Disney stock and vote against these SOBs. You know, vote against everybody on that board of directors. You know, buy every share of stock you can possibly buy in these bad corporations and vote against the people that are doing bad things. So I think we can do a lot.
All right. Thank you.
Sure.
Hi, I'm Peter from Lafayette High School in Williamsburg, Virginia. My question kind of relates to the last one, but as you said, capitalism is an economic system, not a moral creed. With that being said, and with the corruption and immorality apparent in every economic system, what regulations do you think should be put in place on free market capitalism to promote not only a production of wealth within a society, but also morality within that society?
Well, I don't think you can promote morality through the economic system, but I think we need laws to prevent people from acting immorally. And, you know, capitalism does not exist without contract law, without property law, without some government regulation. If regulations that are put in place to actually solve like child labor, you know, we needed child labor laws. I mean, there's I don't think anybody argues with that or anybody reasonably has. But government should also be encouraging business to succeed, which is what happened in the 1850s to about 1900, what they call the Gilded Age, which was an incredible era of prosperity. I mean, 5 million immigrants came to the country. Everybody had jobs. I mean, the whole country was better off. But it was because we gave away land in the West. We put in a rail system, which the government facilitated, although the system was private. You know, we engaged in a number of policies that encouraged business, which is really a role of government. In general, we do need regulations to cut back on, antitrust regulations, for example. We can't let the market be controlled by one or two people. Then it's not free markets. It's one guy or one gal controlling an industry. So we do need laws. There's no doubt about that. But I don't know what ones I could tell you directly would affect people's morality.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Nick. I'm from St. Louis University. So over the past couple of weeks, of course, Elon Musk has been trying to take over Twitter, which, of course, we're all very excited for the prospect of free speech on social media. But many of his critics on Twitter comments have said, like, why isn't he using this money to solve world hunger? So I'm just interested to hear what you would respond to those critics.
I mean, gosh, Elon Musk contributes an incredible amount to charities. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's kind of that's like Elizabeth Warren, who pays no taxes, criticizing Elon Musk for not paying enough in taxes, even though he just paid more than anybody in the history of the world, you know, in tax. I think the problem. I mean, why didn't they ask Jack Dorsey to contribute all his money when he was running? I mean, this is just political. Just ignore that. If they're saying stupid things like that, just pretend they're idiots because you don't really have to pretend.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming today, Mr. Puzder. My name is Will, and I go to Bishop Ireton High School in Alexandria. So my question is, as we have seen the continued problems of outsourcing cheap labor and accumulating massive debt continue to recess the United States economy, how do we encourage corporations to focus on what is best for consumers rather than what is cheapest? And do you think Catholic social teaching can play any role in this sort of, like, encouraging of cultural restraint?
Well, it depends. You know, I think a lot of this is going to change automatically. For example, when President Trump put in place the tariffs on China, you know, China is our number one threat in the world. In case anybody wonders about this, is China. You know, hear about Russia. Russia's a pain in the butt. They have nuclear weapons that makes them a big problem. But their GDP, their economy, it's the same as Italy's. I mean, they just spend it all. I mean, really, they just spend it all on enriching Vladimir Putin and a few of his buddies who buy big boats, and arming the military. But China's the real threat. And when we imposed tariffs, people started to move their sources for supplies out of China. So you move, you know, if you move your manufacturing plant from China to Vietnam, for example, you're not going to move it back if China changes its mind. You spent the money to move it. It's going to stay there. And I think you're going to see more movement out of China, which I think will be helpful for the world and some of these impoverished countries. But I think even what will be even more impactful during your lifetimes is the automation of really any repetitive task. And the tasks that are considered repetitive, you know, get broader and broader because the artificial intelligence can do more and more. And when you can run a plant with artificial intelligence, you really don't need any workers at all. And you can move that plant back to the United States. We're going to have to train people. We need to train people so that they're qualified to work in the tech industry. Because there are going to be plenty of jobs and there's going to be plenty of work to do. But I think the value of taking advantage of these countries with low wages, that's going to decrease. Now, the bad news is that means those people in those countries may not have jobs. So there's always a balance. There's always a balance here. And I think we're entering into a time when this will be a bigger and bigger issue that you people will all have to face as we become more automated. And less manual, or I don't know, is manual female and male, whatever. you know, and less manual labor or female labor, whatever you want to call it.
Femanual.
Thanks. Yeah.
All right, thank you so much.
Thanks.
Hi, my name is Tim Wade. I go to Colby Academy High School. And my question was, what is your opinion of the economic system of distributism? Sort of promoted by G.K. Chesterton, sort of a heavy supporting of local business and keeping companies small. I was wondering what your opinion was on that.
Well, I think it's important to keep companies small, and I think franchising actually should fall within that. We, you know, the company I ran was a big company, but it was really made up of a lot of little companies. You know, we ended up, when I took over, we had about 50% of the restaurants. When I left, we owned 5% of the restaurants. 95% of our restaurants were owned by small businesses. So I think like things like franchising that encourage, and it's a way for us to encourage entrepreneurship and to take advantage of entrepreneurship, because now if we have 200 franchise companies, we have 200 entrepreneurs out there trying to improve our brand and our company. So I think that's a positive. I do think we need large companies to compete internationally, because often we're competing with governments overseas. For example, China is really, it's China Inc. I mean, it's just one big company, so we have to be. We can't break our companies up to the extent where they can't compete internationally. But I think an emphasis on small business is important. 99% of the companies in the United States are small businesses. Now that's a huge number, but they only employ about half the employees. The other 1% employ the other half. So big business has a large role as well. But I'm a big supporter of small business.
Thank you very much.
Hello, I'm Anthony from St. Louis University, and so one of my professors actually referenced that JFK quote that you used about the rising tide lifting all boats, and she said that some people don't even have the boats, so they're just left to drown. So in reference to like historically black communities, for example, in St. Louis, not having access to like community resources to help them rise out of poverty. And she referenced equity as giving everyone those boats or providing everyone with those boats so that everyone can rise up together. And I just was wondering, what would be your response to that?
Well, you know, you can't take what President Kennedy said that literally. What he meant was that economic growth improves everybody's lives. So an assumption in what he said was that everybody had a boat, because he's just talking about people. He's not talking about actually owning boats. it was more of a theoretical, hypothetical comment than it was an actual comment. Like I said, wealth does not solve every problem by itself, but Who would fund those community organizations to help people in the inner cities? Or really any, you know, it could be American, it could be Native Americans. It could be really any community that's disadvantaged. Where's that money going to come from? I mean, you know, the reason that we can address those ills in this country is because We've got an economic system that creates enough wealth that we should be able to address those issues. Now, I think the problem right now isn't that we don't spend enough on solving those issues or those problems. I think the problem is we spend the money very poorly, and we're not using it to encourage work. We're not using it to encourage self-worth. We often use it to discourage work and to discourage self-worth and to keep people dependent on government. I think that's a big mistake. But I think that providing aid to people in underprivileged communities and opportunities to those people is a goal of capitalism and should be a goal of our society in general. We just have to actually be helping people, not oppressing them.
All right, thank you.
Thank you so much for coming. My name's Laura, and I'm from the Catholic University of America. And I'm part of a reading group on campus in which we discuss the spirit of democratic capitalism by Michael Novak. And he talks about the moral, political, and economic underpinnings, and he's addressing socialism. And you mentioned that socialism has you focus on yourself because you're competing for a limited amount of resources, and I think that's where the big idea of equal outcome versus equal opportunity comes from. So I guess I'm just wondering, how do we advocate for capitalism, especially given the current political atmosphere? I'm sorry. how do we advocate for capitalism in a society that's focused on equal outcome rather than equal opportunity?
Well, I think you have to speak to these people very simply and say to them things that they really can't argue with, because their defense of socialism is emotional. It's not rational. It's not historical, because historically you can't defend socialism. It has failed everywhere it has been tried. And I think you need to understand there's a difference between countries that have social welfare systems like Denmark and socialism. Denmark's a capitalist country. You probably all know that. I used to have a section of my talk that talked about how Scandinavian countries are actually capitalist. I took it out because I think Bernie Sanders is the only one who's not smart enough to realize he's defending capitalism when he talks about Denmark. But what I think you should, one thing you can always say to people that I think brings them around is, look, part of it is what you just said, but I'd start with, look, in a capitalist economy, the only way you succeed is by meeting other people's needs. So if you're a capitalist, you are constantly trying to meet other people's needs. You're constantly trying to lift other people up. You're trying to see that other people have what they need, because that's the only way you can succeed. And if they argue with it, that's easy to defend. In a socialist system, you're always trying to take the most you can from the government. I mean, everybody's out there trying to take everything they possibly can. In a society where what is it again that they want? We want everybody to be equal, and they want everybody, we want equal opportunity, they want absolute equality, right? Okay. So in a country where there was absolute equality, there would be no Henry Ford. There would, who would have come up with these cars? There'd been no Thomas Edison. There'd been no Rockefeller or Carnegie. There would have been no Steve Jobs. Steve Jobs started his business in his parents' garage. If there weren't an opportunity for him to improve his life, I don't think he would know who would do that. Or Jeff Bezos, who started Amazon in his parents' garage, who was also adopted. I mean, if you don't have people willing to strive and improve their lives, we don't get the benefit that comes from those people improving everybody's life. And if they can't see that, then there probably isn't much you can do to convince them, because some people just aren't very smart.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Michael. Sorry.
That happened to me yesterday. I'm telling you, it's terrible.
Yeah. Anyway, go ahead. Michael Erickson, Kettle Run, a local high school. I just have to say and ask, I guess, would you say that this socialist where you have to please the
government
the government power, that's not really only with socialist countries, that's slowly moving into the U.S. and other countries. How would you stop that?
Well, our government's too powerful. There was a, I don't know if you studied this in high school, but President Wilson, by the way, President Wilson hated the Constitution and admitted he hated it and wanted to see the government run. He thought we outgrew the Constitution. He wanted to see the government run by a group of elites who we would put in charge of running the nation. And that's how we ended up with our incredible federal bureaucracy, which really is now in the business of handing out benefits to businesses. So you become, it really is a trending towards socialism. In other words, it is trending towards looking to the government for benefits as opposed to trying to build something on your own. And I think it's something we need to cut back on. Look, we need to go in and fire half the people in the federal government. Just get rid of them. Just eliminate them. Reduce these agencies. Get them out of the way. All they're doing is holding back growth and opportunity, and there's no sense in doing that. But you there's a phrase for this. I'm trying to think of corporate. What do they call it? Corporate welfare. If you're out there getting corporate welfare, if the government's handing that out, people are going to compete to get that. And then you've got what you have in a socialist country where people are trying to please the people that are elites. So our country is tending towards that. President Trump tried to cut back. He actually said, told people in the administration that for every new regulation that was adopted while he was president, you had to eliminate two in your agency. Ended up they eliminated eight. There's just a ton of regulation and power in the federal government that needs to be reduced. And we need a powerful conservative leader to go in and do that. And we have some. And hopefully they'll be in power in 2024. We'll just have to wait and see. 2022, 2024 elections are incredibly important for you, your future. I wouldn't have thought that. And if you'd asked me in 2020, early 2020, I wouldn't have said that. After the pandemic hit, that really changed the playing field. These are critical, critical elections coming up.
Thank you.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for coming to speak with us today. I really enjoyed your talk.
Thank you.
My name is Monica DeGuerin. I'm a senior at Villa Maria Academy High School in Malvern, Pennsylvania. As you mentioned today, capitalism brings more wealth to the average person, and I'm interested in healthcare, and I've seen some problems in big capitalist pharma companies. Obviously, socialist healthcare is terrible, but that being said, is capitalism involved in the taking advantage of consumer needs by raising prices of necessary products, just like insulin, because they can? How do we defend capitalism in that case?
Okay, well, if you're talking solely drug prices, you have to look at the individual company and the individual product. I know that the person that invented insulin actually sold the patent for a dollar. He's a Canadian, sold it for a dollar, and so that the price of insulin would be low. You sure like to see more of that, but unlike insulin, a lot of these products take an incredible amount of money to develop, and for every 10 products you spend an incredible amount of money developing, maybe one of them ends up selling. So to stay in business, these companies need to offset prices. And I would point out that the much criticized pharmaceutical industry is the industry that ended up coming up with the vaccines during the pandemic. They didn't come out of China. They didn't come out of, at least not the ones you'd want to take. They came out of Pfizer, which is a huge company, Johnson & Johnson, which is a huge company, and Moderna, which is, that's the one, I went out and got Moderna specifically because it came out of this little startup company that kind of beat everybody else. And I'm glad we have these medical innovations. I think there has to be some profit motive involved for people to invest. People invested money in Moderna, made a lot of money, but there was no guarantee they were going to make anything. I think the bigger problem overall with healthcare is the involvement of government. I think the more you involve government, the more you make healthcare more expensive and you degrade the quality. For example, I often get a question like this about healthcare, and what I normally tell people who come up and say, people are dying in the streets and it's a human right, and this situation in this country is terrible. And I generally respond by saying, well, number one, nobody's dying in the streets. If you go to the emergency room, they have to take care of you, and if you can't pay for it, then it's free. That's number one. Number two, I don't know if it's a human right. Certainly would like to see everybody have health care. It's certainly not a constitutional right. But what's the one thing we can agree on? You and I could probably agree, too, that we'd like to see the quality of health care increase and the cost of health care decrease, right? So what's the one thing in the history of the world that has ever increased quality and decreased price? Competition. When you put government in, what do you know? You're eliminating competition. What's the one thing we know about government? Anytime you put it in anything, the price goes up and the quality goes down. So people who want to advocate for more government control and more government advocacy in the healthcare system, more government involvement, are actually advocating for higher prices and lower quality. What we need is to get a more, there's a great system in Singapore, there's a good book, I can't remember the author, but there's a great medical system in Singapore that actually takes some of the better ideas that we've talked about here in the United States and employed them, including physicians being rated, physicians competing on price, so you don't have the insurance companies in there or the government in there setting prices. They compete for prices, and you can get, for example, heart surgery in Singapore, which is comparable to the United States, for about a third of the price, because they're all competing, and they're you can see what kind of a doctor you have. I mean, they have a healthcare savings accounts, which are very generous. So I think we need to involve more private sector competition, and the more competition there is and the less government is, the better off they'll be. But drug prices are an issue, and I wish they weren't as expensive as they were.
So are you saying you attribute more of the increase in drug prices, like insulin, for example, being a 30,000% increase since it was created? You would attribute that to government involvement versus capitalist?
Yeah, I don't know enough about the insulin issue in particular to comment intelligently to you. I know that, like I said, I knew about the guy who sold it for a dollar, which is what a good guy he was. But I don't know what's happened, why the prices have gone up since. It doesn't make a lot of sense to me. They shouldn't have gone up that much.
Okay, thank you so much.
Sure. Although I tell you, if I were in that profession and the price had gone up 30,000% or whatever it is, and I could manufacture insulin, I would manufacture a cheaper insulin because I'd make a lot of money and get a lot of business, you know. So I mean, hopefully we'll see competition enter that as well. Thanks.
I'm Sophie. I'm from St. Louis University. And I was just wondering, so like in our lifetime, we've heard of like cities like New York and LA and then St. Louis also continue to like get like exponentially worse when it comes to inequality and poverty and violence, especially like Chicago, which isn't too far from St. Louis. So I was just wondering why you think this phenomenon is occurring in our lifetime and what is the government and business's role in trying to fix it?
Well, there's a lot of different answers to that. Let's take income inequality, for example. President Trump came in, he reduced taxes, he reduced regulation, and he increased the focus on domestic energy production. We had wages rising like they hadn't risen in decades. We had inflation lower than it had been in decades, so people were actually making more money. And in 2019, we hit the highest median family income in the history of the country and the lowest poverty rate since they started recording the data back in 1959. This is because people were working and they were making more money at their jobs because inflation was low. We also found for 2 years in a row that income inequality decreased. Now, how many people knew that in 2018 and 2019, following the Trump tax cuts, that income inequality actually decreased both years? Yeah, that's because they don't write about that. So if you want to increase income inequality, increase the incomes of people that are, you know, in the country, as we did in 2019, and decrease costs, which is what happens when incomes are increasing and inflation is below the wage increases. So we are seeing increase. Now, you want to know why there's crime in cities like Chicago and like St. Louis, too. St. Louis's crime is just as bad. If people still go to Ted Drew's, there's not crime there, is there?
People still go to Ted Drew's,
you know, okay, yeah. Which is the best, the concretes. The best in the world. You turn them upside down, they don't come out. Chocolate chip is my recommendation. They're really good. You defund the police, you defund the people that are enforcing the laws. What on earth did you think was going to happen? I mean, if there are less police, if you can't call the police when you're in trouble, if you're not like one of these politicians who can, you know, have their private security guards protect them, I have an apartment in New York, and in the drugstore there's plastic, see-through plastic in front of every shelf now. This wasn't this way back in 2018, 2019. Why is it like that? It's because people come in hordes, and just steal. The Metamucil is behind a plastic. I mean, this is horrific. It's terrible. If we're not going to enforce laws, if we're not going to protect people, then our inner cities are going to collapse. And I think even President Biden has now tried to come out and backtrack on his party's defund the police movement. But, you know, it's still, look, if Chicago wants, that they want things to get better in Chicago or St. Louis, they're going to have to put more money into law enforcement. And that's just the way it is.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Puzder. That was fantastic. Let's give him one more round of applause.
Thanks, everybody.
And we're going to break for a 20-minute recess. All right. Thanks, guys.